Hey folks, today we're going to be talking a little bit more about constraints, and I'm going to give you a bit of a tour of some of the constraints that you can set on an iOS app and why we can do that. So, as we've discussed previously, one of the things that's really important in iOS and mobile development in general is to have UI flexibility, because we have a number of different devices that can appear in a number of different orientations. So constraints give us an opportunity to determine what our view should look like in each of those different sizes and orientations. The example today is going to be an application in which we display information about different drinks, like hot chocolates, lemonades, what have you. So this is going to be a prototype app for that drink catalog, and your base repo already has some drinks in it that you can choose from, which we'll take a look at in a second. So what I've done here so far is I've set up Xcode, I've clicked on this button in the upper right-hand corner, and I've opened my preview screen, which is what you see down here. Then I've come to this Add button in the lower left-hand corner, and what I've done is I've added an iPhone 11 in the landscape orientation. This up here, by the way, is an iPhone 11 in the portrait orientation. I've also added an iPad 11 at full screen size there. So that's going to give us the opportunity to see what our view is going to look like on three different screens before we run our simulator. So this is our screen. We need to add some things to our screen. We're going to have a couple of things going on. We're going to have an image of the drink. We're also going to have the name of the drink. Then we'll have the season that it's best in, and we'll have its deliciousness on screen. So the first thing that we're going to need is an image view. I hit Command Option L, or this button right here in the upper right, to bring up my object library, and what I want is an image view. So I'm going to click and drag that onto my screen. I'm going to roughly center that, and then I'm going to grab it, and I'm going to adjust its height. So you'll notice as I adjust the height, I can see on the upper left-hand corner what the height is. I'm going to make it so that the height and the width are equal. There. Okay, so now I'm going to click on my image view. I'm going to come down to my constraint buttons here. And I'm going to click on the constraint button that we use to set our constraints against the edges of the view. You'll see a checkbox here that says aspect ratio. We're going to add that one constraint. What that does is it says that the size, the width and height of this image view relative to each other will remain the same as the image gets resized. Now in the upper right hand corner over here, you can see that there is an image attribute on this image. We're going to go ahead and set that with some images that I've provided for you in the starter project. So if you click on the drop-down, you'll see some options here at the top for hot chocolate, latte, lemonade, smoothie, and tea. Those are located here in your assets folder, where you can take a closer look at those assets if you're interested. So here you see tea. Here's what the smoothie looks like, and so on and so forth. So for this demo, I am going to use let's go with the lemonade. Okay, so we have the lemonade in there now. Looks like I lost my iPad down here. Hold on. iPad Pro full screen. There we go. All right, so what I'm doing here is I'm zooming in and out on that preview to make it bigger and smaller. Okay, so we have some options with the image view that I'd like to show you as well. The content mode here is currently set to aspect fit, which is going to choose the size for the image where the entire thing fits inside of the image view I've created. I could also use scale to fill, which is going to stretch the image so that it fits. But what I want to use this time, I think, is aspect fill, which is going to cut off the sides of my image in order to display whichever the shorter edge is in full so that my image fills the view. And as we can see here, the lemonade still looks pretty good like that. So now let's start adding some labels to label our drinks. Now we have a label here. I'm going to zoom in a little bit. There we go. Move this over. Okay, so the first thing I want to do is I want to change some things about the way the font looks here. In the attributes inspector here, you'll see that we can set the text to plain or attributed. This is where we can set some custom stuff. In the meantime, though, let's use some of the more standard stuff. So our color here right now is set to black. That's the default label color. I'm going to leave it there for now, although we could change it. I'm interested in changing this font. So currently we're using the system font at a size 17. I'm going to click on this little text button here, the T. And I'm going to leave it at system, but I want to make it a little bit bolder. So I'm going to set it to a medium font weight. And then I'm going to set my size to 32. I like my labels to be big. There we go. So now we have that label. And I'd like to rename that label because we're going to be setting it later. So I'm going to give it a clear name here. So let's call it Beverage Label. Let's also rename our image view so that it's easier to understand later what's going on there. Beverage Image View. I'm double-clicking on these in order to change them. We can also set defaults in here. But I'm not going to do that for now because I want us to make sure that we're hooking up the code properly a little later. Okay, so let's add some more labels to our view for season and deliciousness. We'll need two of them. So we can drag two off of the object library like that. Another option that we have, if I delete one of these labels, is to hit Command V. What happened? Command C, rather, for copy, and then Command V for paste. And that's going to give me another label just like the one I just made. Okay, so let's change some things about the font on this one, too. Let's set our font weight to medium again, and this time let's set our size to 28. Now we want to change the text of this label because this label is going to be demarcating what the season is. Because it'll be a little bit confusing if it just says summer and it doesn't indicate what that label is for. So let's put season, just like that. And then our label here, we're going to rename to Beverage Season Label. Beautiful. And I would like it to be also size 28. However, this time I want my font weight to be light. Looks like it didn't set the font weight. 28. Enter. There we go. All right. So I have these two views. Now, I want these two views to always appear next to each other. So there are a couple of ways that we could do that in iOS. And in the past, what you would have seen is us setting a constraint like this for the horizontal spacing. And then we would also set the baseline spacing. There's a little bit of a more modern trick that we use now to set things relative to each other in iOS. Unless we really want to customize the way that they are related to each other. And that's called a stack view. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to hold down Command, click on Season and Beverage Season Label. And then I'm going to come over to this rectangle with the arrow. And I'm going to embed these two things in a stack view. Now they're embedded in a stack view together, which means they're expected to appear horizontally in a stack relative to each other. We can set vertical stack views too, and we'll do that a little bit later. But in the meantime, I'm going to copy my stack view and I'm going to paste it because I want a very similar thing for my deliciousness label. Now the difference here is going to be that, of course, the label will be different. And we want to rename beverage season label to something like beverage deliciousness label. So far, so good. So now, let's set these things up relative to each other vertically. We have these four things. We know that we want them to appear one on top of the other like this. And so we can do command click. I'm still holding command. I click on all my views. I click on this rectangle. And I'm going to embed those in a stack view. Now you'll notice that the size got wonky. We'll worry about that a little bit later. But as I zoom out, you can see that these things are now embedded in a stack view together where they appear vertically. Okay, so now we're going to talk about how to embed this in a scroll view. And the reason we're going to do that is that you can see that we could resize the stack view to make everything fit on the screen vertically. But on this screen down here, where we have such little vertical space, it would be really hard to get everything in a vertical stack on screen together without the image being too small to really appreciate. And so what we're going to do is we're going to make it so that you can scroll up. You can see the image, and then you can scroll and you can see the text. So I'm going to click on my stack view, click on this rectangle, and I'm going to embed it in a scroll view. And now it looks like the stack view has been replaced with a scroll view here in the view, in the object outline. But what's happened is that when I expand the scroll view, you can see that our stack view now lives inside of it. Now there are 9 constraints that we need to set in order to make this scroll view work with our stack view. And we'll go through them. They're basically in 3 groups. The first one is that we need to pin our scroll view to our root view. And the way that we do that is we hold down control, click and drag from the scroll view to the root view. We're going to set all 4 of these. So those are going to be our 4 constraints. So first I click leading space to safe area, and then I check it and make sure it looks right. One nice thing about constraints is when you click on them in the object outline, you get to look over here on the right at what it looks like. I want my scroll view's leading edge to actually match up with the super view's leading edge, not the safe area. That's important. And I want to set my constant to 0, because that means that the scroll view's leading edge is going to be equal to the root view's leading edge. So I hit enter to set that. I'm going to do that same thing for the top space to the safe area. So right now it says safe area. I'm going to set that to super view, set the constant to 0, and hit enter. We have 2 more of these. Trailing space to safe area. Click on it over here on the left. Scroll view.trailing, we're going to set that to super view.trailing. Perfect. We're going to set the constant to 0. Perfect. And now one more time, control drag, bottom space to safe area. Grab it, change safe area to super view. I haven't found a super intuitive way to get that safe area to change over to super view automatically, so that's why we have to do it manually. So we have our first set of 4 constraints. These are going to pin our scroll view to the edges of our super view. So now we need to do our second set of constraints, which is going to pin our stack view to our content layout guide. So you'll notice that the scroll view came with a content layout guide here. That's going to indicate where the edges should be on the scroll view relative to the content. So we're going to control drag from our stack view to our content layout guide and do the same thing that we did before. Setting our leading constraint to 0. Control drag. Top space. We'll set this also to 0. We're going to keep it simple today and have everything fill the view. Trailing space. Good. And then bottom space. Where's bottom? Here it is. Perfect. So there's one more constraint that we need to set here. And that is a width one on our frame layout guide. So this is going to indicate where the frame takes up space that the stack view moves within. So the stack view to the frame layout guide here, we're going to set to equal width. They're not equal heights, and the reason they're not equal heights is because our content currently is higher than the frame. So the scroll direction needs to be vertical. If you wanted a horizontal scroll, then you would set this to equal heights. And if you wanted it to scroll both ways, then you would set neither. Beautiful. Now our view still looks a little bit wonky, but when we go to take a look at our app, you'll see that if we turn it sideways, we are able to scroll up and see our content.